Well, good morning, everyone. Merry Christmas to you. So good to see you. So glad that you could join us. Roger Boyd is here with us. Roger, it's so good to have you with us today. Roger's going to share a little bit later in the service about his ministry. We have a video that was on 100 Hundley Street this week about the Men's Street Ministry. And then at the end of the service, we're going to need some of your help, because all of this stuff that has been given to support the Men's Street Ministry needs to get out of here, and it needs to be put in a pickup truck and used for the purpose for which it was intended. So we're so excited about that. And I need you to know that this is not just all Shenstone people. There are other people who have caught wind of what is happening and wanted to be a part of supporting this ministry. So it's kind of, I think it's taken on a life of its own a little bit. So that's very exciting as well. A few other things I just want to make note of for you. Do be careful out on the parking lot. It is a little bit slick today. We have put some salt down, but the last thing we want is for someone to go out after service and slip and hurt themselves. So please be very careful on the church parking lot. We do have our Christmas Eve service coming up, so that's going to be Thursday. Can you believe it? Thursday, Christmas Eve, 6 o'clock right here. So please be aware of that. Now, you may know there's going to be some kind of announcement tomorrow by the provincial government about what's going to happen if we go to some kind of Southern Ontario lockdown or whatever. You know, we'll just roll with the punches on that as best we can. If something happens that will affect Christmas Eve, we will let you know. But everything I'm understanding is it'll start Boxing Day, and we'll just have to make adjustments on that. So please be aware of that, and keep your ear to the news. Just a couple reminders as well. Just, you know, we do have to continue to follow protocols. So as, you know, we've got to take this stuff out, but if you would like to fellowship with others, we would ask that you do that outside. I know it's a little chilly today, but it's not that bad. And also, as you're seated, please just be reminded when the monitors ask you or tell you kind of where you should sit, that you go and sit there. And we do need to keep 6 feet as best we can and socially distance. So please be aware of all of those things. That's all the announcements that I need to make. I'm going to open with a word of prayer, and then my dear wife is going to lead us in a couple of Christmas carols. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you. We thank you for this time that we have gathered in your name. And just pray, Lord, that you would bless our time together, that we would honor you with what we say, what we do, what we sing, what we pray, what we preach, Lord. And we just give this next hour over to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Before we sing, can we just turn the fans off? That would be great. Thank you.
Good morning. Please stand if you're able and join me in singing Angels We Have Heard on High. Please be seated.
And thank you for that. Can we just, let's give him a warm Shenstone welcome as well.
Thank you, Pastor. Well, thank you for having me today. And blessings to all of you for helping me along the way with God's ministry. And it's really overwhelming. How God is putting me in this position to do His work, you know. We're working on our fifth year. This is our fifth Christmas that we just celebrated our fifth Christmas service on the street yesterday. And you know, God has led me into a lot of different places, and one place is in Brantford. And my wife and I are moving to Brantford at the beginning of January, January the 8th. We bought a place here in Brantford, and we're looking forward to growing our ministry bigger in Brantford, as well as Hamilton will continue to do that. And we're moving to Mount Pleasant, and God has put it on our heart to build a chapel. A chaplain's chapel in our backyard, so we can grow our ministry where we can have a kitchen and do all the cooking and stuff, because right now we're up to about 2,000 sandwiches a week, and we're about 70 gallons of soup, and it's just been amazing. And you know, the blessings that we get help us along the way. And can you see, when you saw that video, can you see the joy in their faces? That's the Holy Spirit. You know, they don't come to hear me because I'm not a very good preacher. You know, I just tell them how I feel and what God wants to give them is their salvation. And they don't come for the food, because they can get food anywhere. It's the Holy Spirit that speaks to them, and they come week after week. And it doesn't matter how hard it's raining or snowing or how cold it is, they still come. And I tell them, that's the Holy Spirit working in you. And we've led over 50 men and women to Christ. And right now we're just waiting for the pandemic to slow down a little bit. We have about 6 more people to baptize. And there's a church in Hamilton, New Testament Baptist Church. They lend us their baptism tub, and we baptized a few people that were just really in need to be baptized because of health issues. And it's just been truly a God's blessing. And I want to share this with you, the church, that as I was drinking my coffee this morning, God put this verse on me, and I thought it was so appropriate for you. And it's Romans 12:10 to 13. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spirit favor, serving the Lord. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. And that verse represents what you guys have done for the ministry here, providing all this food. And you guys should be very proud of yourselves, and that God has spoken to you guys, put it on your heart to help His ministry. And I can't do it alone. We have about 50 volunteers that help us on a weekly basis. And we're just so blessed. And I want to just thank you for all your support through not just that Christmas time, but all through the year. I think I've been here about five times, and I think you're going to see Janet and I here more than you think. And yeah, because we're just going to be moving down the road. So thank you. God bless you. Thank you, Pastor.
Well, thank you, Roger, and thank you for coming and sharing, and we're excited that you'll be here in Brantford, and we're excited we'll see you a little bit more, and I'm just going to say, I'm going to go out on a limb here, but if you need a baptismal tank, we have one here too, and we would love to help you out in that way. If there are those in Brantford who'd like to be baptized, for sure. Well, we're going to take a moment to pray, and we're going to pray a blessing on the Men's Street Ministry. We're going to pray that these goods will be used. There's not just food up here. There's blankets, and there's socks, and all kinds of stuff. And we're going to pray that God will use these things to bless those that the Men's Street Ministry encounters, but opens the door for gospel conversations. Like, this is a labor of love, is it not? That we do this because of love and care for others in a way of helping them. And we're just going to pray that God does a mighty work. Let's go to the Lord together, shall we? Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you, and we are humbled to hear of the mighty work that is being done through the Men's Street Ministry. We are humbled to hear how you are just using it to touch lives. And we thank you for Roger. We thank you for his love for you. We thank you for his wife and their ministry. We thank you that you have allowed them to move to Brantford and just find a place that will help them to grow that ministry. Lord, we pray that it will just continue to reach the homeless in Hamilton and Brantford, that hearts will be opened and lives will be changed by the gospel. Lord, I thank you for each and every one who has committed to helping out this Advent season by the giving of these goods that we see here on the platform today. And Lord, may they go out. May they go out, Lord, with all the love that was intended as people picked up these supplies and wanted to help. And we pray, Lord, that they will be used to further your kingdom and touch the lives of the many who will receive these things. Lord, we thank you for Shenstone, that we could be a part of this. We thank you for the heart of the people who have contributed to this and all those others who are not part of the church. Lord, I just ask a special blessing on this church. May we continue to find ways to serve you like this, continue to reach out into Brantford and beyond with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we think of those among our church family who are hurting or who have gone through significant health issues in the very recent past. We continue to think of Kathy as she recovers from her surgery. Lord, as they have another appointment coming up, that they will just hear good things, Lord, and just be with Eric and Kathy. We thank you for the blessing that they have been to Shenstone over these years. Lord, we think of Barb Patton. We thank you that she is at home, came home this week. Lord, we thank you that we've been able to come alongside them by providing them with meals and encouragements, and what a blessing that they have received, and we're so grateful, Lord, that you have used us in that way. We continue to pray for the Rummies as they continue to quarantine on their trip back from Romania. Lord, we just ask that you would have your healing hand on Mike as he continues to recover from the surgery and deal with the pain. Lord, that his appointments with the chronic pain clinic will just help him to alleviate that. May this 3 months that they are to be here just be a time of renewal and refreshing. And Lord, may you continue to bless their ministry. Lord, too, I just want to pray for Jamie and Karen Bowen's nephew, Andrew Emerson, who's a young man who had some neck surgery and is facing some significant complications as a result. Lord, may your hand of healing be upon him. I give doctors wisdom as they help him and try to figure out exactly what to do. Lord, be with Jamie and Karen as they support in whatever way they can their nephew. Lord, now we're going to turn to your word. And I pray, Lord, that we will just have a deep passion for understanding your message. I pray, Lord, that we are not a people who ignore your word from Monday to Saturday. I pray that you will just give us a strong desire to read it, to understand it, and to apply it. Lord, may we encourage one another in this way to be students of your word. Lord, as we now look at Isaiah 61, Lord, I would pray that you would be with me as I share your message. Lord, that I would not get in the way of what you would want to communicate. That we are receptive to what your Holy Spirit will do. We pray these things in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen. Well, I'm going to encourage you, if you do have your copy of God's Word, to turn to Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah chapter 61. Now that's very curious. Isaiah chapter 61. Let us hear the words of the living God together. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of the vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. Aliens will shepherd your flocks. Foreigners will work your fields and vineyards. And you will be called priests of the Lord. You will be named ministers of our God. You will feed on the wealth of nations, and in their riches you will boast. Instead of their shame, my people will receive a double portion. And instead of disgrace, they will rejoice in their inheritance. And so they will inherit a double portion in their land, and everlasting joy will be theirs. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and iniquity. In my faithfulness, I will reward them and make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants will be known among the nations and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them will acknowledge that they are a people the Lord has blessed. I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the soil makes the sprout come up and a garden causes seeds to grow, so the Sovereign Lord will make righteousness and praise spring up before all nations. This is the word of the Lord. Well, I have a confession for you. Some of you may know this already, but I really enjoy superhero films, and including, you know, those animated ones like Megamind and The Incredibles, and The Incredibles 2, which was okay, but not as good as the first Incredibles. And one of the things that is interesting is that Culture historians will tell you that the proliferation of superhero movies really began after 9/11. There were a few here and there before that, but when 9/11 hit, after that, that's when we began to see a lot of superhero movies come into the theaters. You may be familiar with the Batman trilogy with Christian Bale, who plays Batman, and what is fascinating to me about that film is that Batman, one of the great American superheroes, is actually played by a Welshman. And that is kind of interesting. You may have seen the Spider-Man films with Tobey Maguire, and then of course there's the Spider-Man reboot with Andrew Garfield, and then there was the second Spider-Man reboot with Tom Holland, who is a part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. If you ever hear anyone refer to the MCU, they are talking about the Marvel Cinematic Universe, which is now up to, I believe, 25 films, including my favorite superhero, which is the mighty Thor. I will tell you that there are some other films put out by DC Comics, but none of them are as good as the MCU films, so don't waste your time on those, unless it's the Batman trilogy with Christian Bale. And whether you've seen them or not, they are quite popular. Many of them have made over $1 billion in the theater. And of course, the Avengers Endgame became the highest grossing film of all time, raising over $2 billion as people flock to the theaters to go and see them. Why is that? Why are these films so popular? Now, some of you here may not have seen all of them yet, but of course you're looking forward to time at Christmas when you can just sit down and watch all those movies. If that's on your list, I'm sure. But why are these films so popular? Is it because there's just strong, strapping individuals? Is it because that the visual effects are so remarkable and amazing? And those things may be true, but I think these movies attract people because there is a deep longing inside each of us for someone who will stand up for what is good. Someone who will stand up for what is right. Someone who will stand up for those who cannot stand up for themselves. Someone who is noble and brave and willing to sacrifice themselves for the betterment of humanity. Now, you could argue that not all of the superheroes in the superhero universes are noble, but they are brave. And there is the theme of sacrifice that runs through every single superhero movie, where they are willing to put themselves on the line against some kind of remarkable foe and are even willing to die if necessary to save others. And that is particularly prominent in the first Thor film and in the Superman movies, with Henry Cavill playing Superman in Superman versus Batman, and then in Justice League. I hope I didn't give any spoilers for you. Have you noticed that superheroes also, or simply heroes, often come from another place in their stories? If you love fairy tales, Prince Charming always comes from another land to come and save the princess in distress. Beowulf comes to help the Danes. He is not Danish, but he comes from another land to help the Danes. Superman comes from Krypton. Batman goes to get training from Ra's al Ghul before he comes back to Gotham. Thor comes from Asgard. All of them are savior-like figures, rescuing people who cannot rescue themselves because the enemy is too great. Regular people can't defeat Lex Luthor, or the Joker, or Thanos. In all of these stories, there is something that we connect with, something that touches people deeply, whether it's the superheroes of today or it's the fairy tales of years gone by. There is something in them that draw us to them. I think it's a desire to see the world righted. What if these heroes didn't just reside in the imagination? What if there is someone who could truly make things better? There is someone who could bring necessary change. What if there is someone who could not just defeat the external foes that we face, but there was someone who could defeat our internal struggles, like sin? What if there was someone that great? The people of Isaiah's day have hearts that need to change, but it's obvious that they cannot do it themselves. They are a hurting people. If you remember when we first began this series, there's our superheroes. If you write them all down and get them all right, you get some kind of prize, I'm sure. But when Isaiah describes the people that he is talking about, this is how he begins. In Isaiah chapter 1, he says, this is God speaking, why should you be beaten anymore? Why do you continue to put yourselves in all of these difficult circumstances? Why do you persist in rebellion? Your whole head is injured. Your whole heart is afflicted. From the sole of your foot to the top of your head, there is no soundness, only wounds and welts and open sores not cleansed or bandaged or soothed with soils. They are soil. There is a nation that is constantly under attack by surrounding nations. Their leadership, whether kings or priests or false prophets, have led them astray. And at the end of Isaiah 8, we saw a couple weeks ago, at the end of Isaiah 8, in the beginning of chapter 9, they are described as being in darkness, distress, and fearful gloom. But God is working to draw his people back to himself. And so we give you this quiz, right? First word. Invitation. And that's what we saw in Isaiah chapter 1. We saw that God has invited people. Come, let us reason together. Though your sins be like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. God invites us. It is a personal invitation to come to him, but it is also an invitation to a person. And we've seen that as we've gone through Isaiah. So God invites. What else does God do? Immanuel, God with us. We saw with Ahaz that Ahaz was a terrible man, yet God sent his prophet to Ahaz. And he said, look, be careful. Be calm. Do not be afraid. There's an answer for you. If you just put your faith in me, I'll give you a sign, any sign you want. Ahaz rejected that sign, but Isaiah said there is a sign that will come. It is Immanuel, God with us. A child will be born. A child we celebrate every Christmas. God with us. God promises us his presence. This one. Illumination. The people living in darkness have seen a great light. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 and 2. And then God goes on to describe what that light is. In fact, who that light is. A child. Wonderful Counselor. Mighty God. Everlasting Father. The Prince of Peace. So those of us who are living in darkness, we are able to see. We are able to see by the light of Jesus Christ, who calls himself the light of the world. And our final one. Now, I don't know if any of you noticed I made a mistake last week. The third candle should always be the pink candle. That is done. So forgive me for that, if you will. Incarnation. Incarnation. We have invitation, Immanuel, illumination, and incarnation. God in the flesh, God visiting earth, experiencing humanity, all of the struggles, yet without sin, God coming into the world to save humanity. God sends a person, a real hero, who brings real change, one who is known as the Anointed One, the Christ, the Messiah. He is the one who can right the wrongs of the world and transform our lives if we put our faith in him. There's all of our I letters, so Christmas Eve, remember those. First point, the Anointed brings the good news. The Anointed One brings the good news. Today we're going to take a giant step on Isaiah, and we're going to go almost to the end of the book. We're going to hit chapter 61, which we read. There's 66 chapters in Isaiah, filled with all kinds of great stuff. But we're going to come to Isaiah 61 today, and here we read of the Anointed One who comes with good news. That's what it says. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach the good news. You see, the Anointed comes in the power of the Spirit. Isaiah references this also in Isaiah chapter 11. If you have your Bible, just turn over there with me. Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 to 3. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. So that is somebody from the line of Jesse, who is the father of David. And from his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of power, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. He will delight in the fear of the Lord. This is the same one that is being spoken of in Isaiah chapter 61. And this one will come from the line of David. The kings of Judah that Isaiah is facing, you know, he has four that he kind of speaks to, and three of them are good. Three of them are okay. Three of them are trying to do what is right and lead their people well. They are serving God. But even near the end of these three good kings, their pride overcame them. And instead of giving credit to God, they started to think of how great they were and how they had built up their nation and how the wealth of their kingdom was something they had done, particularly Uzziah and Hezekiah. And another was bad, Ahaz, who we learned about 2 weeks ago. He is a terrible man. And the one that is to come is not like any of these men. He comes from the line of David and the power of the Holy Spirit. That means he will have God's wisdom, God's understanding, God's counsel, God's power, God's knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. He will live in complete submission to the will of the Father. In fact, he will delight in it. Now, would you follow someone who would always do what is right, who knew you could count on them every single time, that they would never fail, and they would do it in great humility? Would you follow someone like that? Because that is who is being described in this passage. He is unlike any human ruler that has ever come. We see that the anointed is chosen by God. The idea of anointing means that he is set aside specifically by God for a purpose or task. It's primarily used in the Old Testament of kings and priests. A person with a special calling to represent God. The verb is masa or masha in the Hebrew. The noun form is Messiah. The Messiah is the anointed of God, authorized by God for his service, sent to carry out God's work and God's will. The Greek word for Messiah is Christ. It's a title. Every time that you utter the word Christ, or you use it with his name, Jesus Christ, or Christ Jesus, you are invoking his unique status as the anointed one who has God's spirit and God's power, who is doing God's will and is doing God's work. He is God incarnate, God in the flesh, who walked on this earth 2,000 years ago. So we read about the life of Christ in the Gospels and the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We see the Spirit heavily involved in the life of Christ. If you recall that when Jesus is baptized, and there is a voice from heaven that says, "This is my Son whom I love, with you I am well pleased," and the dove comes down, or the Holy Spirit comes down like a dove. Right after that, the Holy Spirit drives Jesus into the wilderness to be tempted by the Satan. And not only is he tempted, but he is victorious. And when he returns to Nazareth, he returns in the power of the Spirit. Luke chapter 4 and verse 14, where he teaches in the synagogue and where he reads these words. Turn with me to Luke chapter 4. You know, I said a couple weeks ago that maybe we should read scripture like we watch our sports and be a little more kind of energetic about it. In Luke chapter 4, I'm not going to scream today, don't worry. Jesus went to Nazareth, starting in verse 16, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom, and he stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll. He gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And I love this next part. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. They are waiting to see what is he going to say next. There is something so captivating about Jesus that they cannot help but listen to what he has to say. And he begins to say to them, "Today the scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." This one that Isaiah was speaking about over 700 years ago in Isaiah chapter 61 is right here in front of you. I have fulfilled this passage. God's plan is coming to fruition. Now, today is used a handful of times in the Gospel of Luke, and each time it's used, something significant is taking place. Three of these examples include when the angels say to the shepherds, "Today in the town of Bethlehem, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord." The angels announce that Jesus has come that very day. Here, Jesus is proclaiming in the synagogue that he is the anointed one sent by God. They are seeing scripture fulfilled that very moment. When Jesus says of Zacchaeus, "Today salvation has come to this house," Zacchaeus, today, you are a son of Abraham. You are a child of God. You are saved this very moment. And when Jesus is hanging on the cross, he assures the thief of his eternal destination, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Today, that very day, within that 24-hour period, it is true. So Jesus boldly declares that he is the one who comes with the good news, who is anointed and sent by God. He is God incarnate. What do we learn about this good news? This good news that the Anointed One brings, that the Christ brings, it transforms. It's news that transforms. Back in Isaiah chapter 61, we read these verses, but again, hear these words. "To preach good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for captives, release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, to comfort those who mourn." These are transformative statements, and I've created this nice little chart to help you. Notice what he does. Here are the people, the poor, the brokenhearted, captives and prisoners and mourners, and those who are grieving in ashes. Their despair is so great that they cover themselves in ashes. They are living in a spirit of despair. I don't know if you've ever fallen into any of those categories. I think there's a lot of people in despair today. I think there's a lot of people who are hurting. I think this pandemic has just ground them down. People who are brokenhearted. The poor are all around us. But notice what Jesus does. What is the action of the Christ? He preaches good news. That word evangelism is kind of, we borrowed a Greek word that's really hard to pronounce in Greek. And we take it and we say evangelism or evangelistic or being evangelist. It simply means the good news, to share the good news. And Jesus binds. A lot of people who need to be helped and healed today, aren't there? And Jesus comes alongside and he's able to bind their wounds. He proclaims freedom to those who specifically are stuck in sin, to those whose lives have become such a mess and people don't know where to go and they don't know where to turn. He releases people from darkness. Oh, I love that imagery. People whose lives are just, there's no way out. They don't know what to do. They don't know where to turn. They can't turn because they can't see, because they're in darkness. Jesus is able to release them. He proclaims a year of favor, the good news of God, a day of vengeance against those who continue to be opposed to God. God will correct the wrongs. He will right the wrongs. He will comfort and bestows a crown of beauty. Those ashes of pain are changed for a crown of beauty. It's a great song. I don't think we ever sung it here. We need to introduce it. That's based on these very verses. Jesus does that in garments of praise instead of a spirit of despair. Jesus transforms people. One of these pictures is finding freedom. Freedom is a technical term here. It's used in the year of Jubilee. It's found in Leviticus chapter 25, verses 8 through 55. And in the Old Testament, under the people of God, what would happen is every 49 years, if you had sold yourself into slavery, if you had sold your land, in the year of Jubilee, the slaves would be set free. The land would be returned to the family to whom it belonged. Every 49 years. Why is that? Because the people belonged to God and the land belonged to God. Those are very important covenant themes. And so God has this time where he resets the entire economic table for the benefit of everyone. And so there is this freedom. The slavery or the selling of land was never a permanent situation. The good news is transformational because it brings freedom. And then beauty into ashes, this transformation continues. Ashes are always a sign of heavy grief, we mentioned that. And Jesus replaces that with a crown of garland of beauty on the head, an oil of gladness and a garment of praise are symbols of transformation as well. Jesus prepares them for a celebration of joy. Gone are the clothes and signs of sadness. Can Jesus really do that? Can Jesus really take a life that is broken and poor and held by all kinds of pain and change it? Yes, he can do that. Now, you may have had moments of your life in doubt. Have you ever, let's be honest, have you ever doubted? I've doubted. We've all doubted. Those moments that are just hard and let me bring you some comfort, if I may. John the Baptist doubted. Did you know that? John the Baptist, who is the herald, the forerunner of the Christ, the man who went out in the wilderness and preached, and people flocked to hear him, and he had preached a message of repentance. His ministry was amazing. But then he preached against Herod and Herodias. And Herod had married his brother's wife, and that is against the law. And so John the Baptist called him out. He got arrested. He was thrown in prison. And while he was in prison, he was wondering, is this Jesus really the one that I was supposed to be the forerunner for? I thought maybe things would move a little quicker now that Jesus was here. I thought things would change a little more rapidly. I thought that God would work in a faster way. Those thoughts you've ever had. And then we read, Jesus responds, because it's the disciples of John the Baptist who've gone to Jesus to ask him if he was the one to come. And Jesus answers them, go and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, the poor have good news preached to them. And blessed is the one who was not offended by me. Jesus is saying this, John, it's happening. Your faith is not misplaced. Lives are being changed. The good news is being preached. Today we've heard of 50 individuals who have given their life to Christ through the Men's Street Ministry. Because the gospel is effective and the gospel is transformative. Take heart! I'm the one. There is no one else. Lives are being transformed. That's what Jesus is saying to John the Baptist. Jesus is bringing the good news, and the good news transforms. And he does this ultimately through the cross. See, because the best news for all of us is that all that sin that we have can be overcome through Jesus Christ. That all of that sin that we have, all those things that we have done that are wrong, that not only offends others but offends God, that we are guilty of, Jesus died on the cross for our sins so that we could be forgiven. That is the good news of Jesus Christ. That's what we celebrate, not only at Christmas but all year round. Jesus dies for our sins that we may be freed. And lastly, the good news calls us to minister. The good news calls us to minister. So the transformation moves from the inward to the outward. Because it has transformed us inwardly, we are now called to live it outwardly because we are changed and called to serve God's purposes. One of the things I love is that the people of God are referred to as oaks of righteousness. They've been transformed by a crown of beauty, by oil of gladness and a garment of praise, and now they are symbolized as oaks of righteousness that are planted for the display of the splendor of God, or for God's glory. Now that you have been transformed by the good news of the Christ, you are now on display for God's glory. Does that change how you live among other people? If you are to be displayed as an oak of righteousness so that other people can see the glory of God in your life and what God has done for you, the oak is a symbol of strength. No longer are we overwhelmed by sin, but because of what God has done, we stand strong. And we become symbols of what God can do for others. It's God's righteousness, God's empowerment that allows us to become like an oak. And in verse 11, we read that the sovereign Lord will make his righteousness spring up among all nations. But not only are we displayed for God's glory, those that the Anointed One transforms will become priests and ministers of God. That's what it says in verse 6, and you will be called priests of the Lord, and you will be named ministers of our God. We become ministers of God. And Peter picks up on this theme in 1 Peter 2, 9 and 10. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are a people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. And because we have received this mercy, we are called to go to others on God's behalf to help them, to intercede for them in prayer and represent God to them. These oaks of righteousness and priests and ministers of the Lord are called to rebuild, restore, and renew. That is our ministry. That is what we are called to do. So let me conclude. When you say, "I am a Christian," you are saying, "I am a Christ one." That I am one belonging to Jesus, who is the anointed of God, who proclaims the good news and who transforms lives. You are saying Jesus has transformed my life and he can transform yours. You are saying I am now a minister of God sharing his good news. And you want to rebuild. And you want to restore. And you want to renew others. So when we say we are a Christian, we are making a bold claim. We are making a strong statement. And if we are going to claim the name of Christian, well, we better live it out. We had better live it out. So at Christmas, we are invited to come to God through the person of Jesus Christ, to be healed of our fractured nature that sin has caused. Jesus will make things right. Jesus comes with the good news of transformation, the good news of forgiveness, the good news of ministering. God has made it plain. He wants us to come. If God sends his prophet to a terrible king like Ahaz, God will send his messenger to anyone he chooses, that they may hear the gospel of Christ and have the opportunity to respond. So let us acknowledge what we are when we say we are a Christian. When we speak of the Anointed One who has brought good news, and let us preach it to others. Because there's a lot of people out there who are brokenhearted. There's a lot of people out there who are mourning, who are grieving, who are in despair. And you are the one, and I am the one entrusted with that message, that they too may be transformed. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for your word and how you have just so clearly given us Jesus Christ, that you have provided for us good news, that we may hear it and respond, that we may be transformed. But it doesn't stop there. Our faith is not meant to be private. Our faith is meant to be shared, because it is your desire that all people will hear the gospel. It is your desire that all people will repent and be saved, but the choice is ours. So Lord, let us not shy away from the call to preach the good news. Let us not keep it to ourselves, but proclaim it and point others to Jesus the Christ, that the poor and the captive and the prisoner and the mourner and those grieving in ashes, those living in darkness, can see Jesus and feel his transformation too. We pray these things in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen.
Please stand if you're able and join us in singing, "How Great Is Our God." Just stretch for a minute then. Here we are. How great, how great, how great.
Do you believe that this morning? We serve a great God. Even in the midst of a pandemic, he is still great. Well, we're going to close in prayer, and just a couple things. If you have brought offering, there are offering boxes at the back. Please drop those in. I'm guessing a truck will have to be backed up, and then we can deliver that stuff in. So if you're going to help move these boxes, this is how I'd like to see it happen. If we can come up this way, grab something, and then go out that way. And that way we're not passing each other quite as frequently, right? If you're just leaving, that's fine. Go ahead and do that. If you want to fellowship in the parking lot, please go ahead and do that. Make sure your coat's on and all bundled up. Please be careful on the parking lot. But if you can help, please, we're going to do kind of a circle that way. All right? Let us pray together. Oh, what a great way to end our service, Heavenly Father, singing of your greatness. The greatness of our God. Lord, I hope that that is humbling for us. I hope that that is challenging for us. And I hope that it is a wonderful reminder of the greatness of Jesus Christ who came to this earth for us. There is no other reason for Jesus to come. There is no other reason for the second member of the Trinity to take on flesh, but simply because he loved us and saw us in our sinful state and desired that we could be transformed, that we could be forgiven, and that we can be granted access to an eternity in the presence of you. So Lord, we're thankful for that. And while we look forward to that day, we know we are here for a purpose, to serve you, to be ministers of your gospel, whether formally or informally. So Lord, I pray that today we leave with a renewed sense of optimism, with a renewed sense of hope, and in a renewed sense of commitment to share this transformative good news with others. And again, we thank you for this opportunity to partner with the Men Street Ministry. Lord, people out there on the front line reaching others for you with that transforming message. So we continue to pray a blessing on Roger, his ministry here and in Hamilton, on Roger and his wife. Help them to continue to do your work and help us to do everything we can to support them in that work. We pray these things in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen.